as I lean into your body, you connect me. Blessed be the trees. Every answer is revealed beneath your shade, and I see mysteries unfold on this very page. Wisdom whispers through your leaves, and I breathe in your essence, and I am humbled by your. Of heaven standing tall, breath of life, home to all, mother's healing gift of life, yet another from thee. Blessed be the trees. Ooh, ooh. I'm in all the shadows that sign your name, and I can feel what your spirit is saying to me. It's saying to me, blessed be the trees.
I want to welcome everyone here. I'm Reverend Sue. This day we've been waiting for a long time. We lost our Karen many months ago, and now is the right and perfect time to celebrate her life and our love for Karen. And it has been an incredible opportunity to love her and to show our respect. And so many people have come forward. What else can I do? What else can I do? And so you might have wondered, are all these chairs saved? But those are Karen's scarves and hats. And we ask that you find your favorite and take it with you. It's allowing you to take a piece of her love and her joy. Can you imagine her shopping and just enjoying whatever it was and just wearing it with care and energy? So many people to thank, and we couldn't include them all in your program. The list goes on and on. She touched all our lives. I was sharing with a couple of people that she made us all feel like we were her best friend. And every one of us think, well, I should speak there. I was the best friend. And we, I don't know, because if you were, then so were 100 others. So what we're going to do today is create it like a Taze service, really create energy that Karen loves. And each one of us also expressed this feeling of Karen tapping on us, saying, I like that, let's go there, let's do this. We feel her smile and her warmth always with us. So this is what she would like. So no applause, just pure joy. Just keep putting your hands to your heart and let the emotions flow, both joy and sadness, if that's what you're feeling. It's what she would appreciate. So afterwards, we're going to join in the social hall for a celebration. And at that time, we can share more stories of Karen. But right now, you're going to hear some of her music, things she wrote, groups that she was very integral in helping to create and inspire. You're going to hear readings of her personal writings, things that touched her heart in various ways. So, and from her favorite family is going to be here, and Pam will introduce those people in just a few moments. But right now, I found this beautiful prayer, and I thought about Karen, and it's a four directions prayer. We're not going to each stand, but to move in all the directions, because we can feel it in our heart. So just join with me in this knowing as I speak this prayer for Karen. Creator, it is I. It is Karen. Thank you for today's sunrise, for the breath and the life within me, and for all of your creations. Creator, hear my prayer. Honor my prayer. As the day begins with the rising sun, I ask, Spirit Keeper of the East, Brother Eagle, be with me. Fly high as you carry my prayers to the Creator. May I have eyes as sharp as yours so I am able to see truth and hope on the path that I have chosen. Guide my step and give me courage to walk the circle of my life with honesty and dignity. Speaker, Spirit, Keeper of the South, the Wolf, be with me. Help me to remember love and feel compassion for all mankind. Help me to walk my path with joy and love for myself, for others, for the four-legged, the winged ones, the plants, all creation upon Mother Earth. Show me it is right for me to make decisions with my heart. Even at times, my heart becomes hurt. Help me to grow and nurture my self-worth in all ways. Oh, Speaker, Spirit, Keeper of the West, Brown Bear, be with me. Bring healing to the people I love and to myself. Bring into balance the physical, mental, and spiritual so I am able to know my place on this earth, in life and in death. Heal my body, heal my mind, and bring light, joy, and awareness to my spirit. Spirit Keeper of the North, White Buffalo, be with me. As each day passes, help me to surrender with grace the things of my youth. Help me to listen to the quiet and find serenity and comfort in the silences as they become longer. Give me wisdom so I am able to make wise choices in all things which are put in front of me. And when the time for my change of worlds has come, let me go peacefully without regrets for the things I neglected to do as I walked along my path. Mother Earth, thank you for your beauty and for all that you have given me. Remind me never to take from you more than I need, and remind me always to give back more than I take. So every life is precious, precious. It contributes to each and every one of us. And it is Karen's energy and love that draws us together in this room. So today, thank you, God, for the gathering and the celebration of the life of Karen Coffey. Coming together in community, we join our consciousness in a prayer that calls us in. I invite us all to join at the altar of our heart where joy and love reside. Let us know our grief. Let us feel our grief. Let us be touched by memories of good times and smile. Let us feel the courage of Karen in her life's journey, the work she has done, the rivers she has cleaned, the land she has trusted so, every animal she has blessed. We're here to honor Karen and celebrate, and today our laughter and tears come together to share the legacy of a life well lived. We know that this life is held in a greater love, and we are grateful. We are so grateful for a place and friends to share and celebrate this amazing woman. So I release the intention of this prayer, knowing that the grace of God carries us along this day. So much love is in this room. I let it be so, and so it is. So in your program, you have the words to the first song, and I'll invite them up, and we'll carry on.
The songs we chose to sing with you and for you today, Honor Karen, are among her favorites, as you must know, and remind us of her great love for life, all life and music. She was a song sprite and one of our song sisters. What a blessing she was to all of us. And I know that Karen's spirit sings through this lovely guitar that I am so privileged and honored to play. It's her guitar. Please join us as we sing, Give Yourself to Love.
Kind friends all gathered round, there's something we would say, that what brings us together here has blessed us all today. Love has made a circle that holds us all inside, where strangers are as family and loneliness can't hide. You must give yourself to love, if love is what you're after. Mountains in the rain, I've learned to love the wind. I've been up before the sunrise to watch the day begin. I always knew I'd find you, though I never did know how. Like sunshine on a cloudy before me now. So give yourself to love, if love is what you're after. Open up your heart to the tears and laughter, and give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. Love is born in fire, is planted like a seed. Love can't give you everything, but it gives you what you need. Love comes when you're ready. Love comes. is what you're after. Open up your heart to the tears and laughter and give yourself to love. Give yourself to love.
Yes,
give yourself to love. Give yourself to
Hi, I'm Terry Krauska, Karen's friend. Well, I woke up last Saturday to the snow falling, and it was so beautiful and thrilling, and my first reaction was to excitedly call Karen. That is something we would have done. So after I opened the blinds and made coffee, I decided that this was the moment that I would think about what I wanted to say. And oh, how she would have loved that morning. But it was harder than I thought to sum up a fitting tribune, to think of what I really wanted to say to her, to myself, to all of you. Of course, I wanted to mention what others probably will say about her intense love for animals, and except for rattlesnakes. She hated rattlesnakes and was always super vigilant about them, and I would laugh at her. And now look, Karen, see? When we were together, we never once saw a rattlesnake. But other animals, oh, how she loved them. From wild animals and wolves and birds to all of her pet-sitting dogs and cats. But I do think that she loved my cat the best. But possibly some of you here today think that she loved yours the best. So but that's because, wow, she really loved animals. Of course, I wanted to mention nature, how she loved nature and the earth, and how she loved the sky and the moon and trees and rivers and lakes and oceans. But as I sat there and thought, what was the most special thing I loved and wanted to remember Karen for? And it was what she meant to me. It was what she brought out in me, and that was the ability to be silly. She brought out the inner 8-year-old spirit in me. And this was a special and priceless gift, the permission to be really goofy. I know she did this with others too, but we would make funny faces at each other and sing silly songs as we went for a walk or break into a little dance for no reason and make over my fat cat with ridiculous fawning and baby talk. And she was one of the few who would come to my cat's birthday party. I think it takes a lot of confidence in yourself to be so silly and vulnerable and lighthearted and not be afraid that others might laugh at you and not with you. That is what I loved most about Karen. What I loved and will miss the most is what she brought out in me, how I felt when I was around her. I will always inwardly smile when I think about her lighthearted spirit. I will miss her being with me in person so much. And yet, I would be remiss if I didn't also acknowledge her serious side that I admired also, her caring side. She was a true friend to me in the bad times, when the chips were down. I know she was this person to many others too. It's easy to be a friend in the good times, but Karen was there for me and for so many others during the sick times, the dying times, or just the crying times. This is a good, true friend, and she was the one who would be there when your mother died or your brother died or your husband or your wife died. Or maybe your spouse or boyfriend left you or your dog died or you were in the hospital or sick at home. It was likely Karen who was there to comfort you. Thank you, Karen. Thank you for your selfless service. Thank you for everything you've been to each of us here. So yesterday, I picked up my small monthly pocket planner and was with drawings and quotes by a lady named Kelly Ray Roberts, and I was putting some reminders in it when I started to read each month's quotes, and suddenly it felt as if they were about Karen. Listen to some of these. She leapt with the gentlest courage, faith, and joy. Her journey was exquisite. Her spirit was as brave as the brightest star in the sky, allowing the unfolding. Or this one. Dear you, permission granted to dream bigger and let your spirit soar. Trust your inner journey. There was so much more I could say. She was my best friend. I looked it up in my journal. We met August 13th, 2011. So a little more than 5 years. I know she had a whole lifetime that she lived before I knew her. I only know a little teeny bit about it, but it seems like she was so engaged in her life, all of her life. And she was also the one who introduced me to the Spiritual Center and to each and every one of you here today. So thank you for that, Karen. Even though in the last year she must have known that she was living on borrowed time, she never seemed to let it get her down. She modeled how we all should live, and I hope in my next few years I can remember the way she lived. 5 years, a small percentage of my total life, yet she impacted me in a disproportionate way. She will be a big part of my life story. One last poem. I didn't write this, but I have it on my puja in honor of my family and friends who have crossed over. I know Karen, beyond all others, loved this earth and all its magical creations. I know she loved, loved, loved life. But I also know that she would want me, all of us, to live on, as in this quote. So here's to you, Karen. Thanks for being a very special friend and for enriching my life, our lives. So, as long as I can, I will look at this world for both of us. As long as I can, I will laugh with the birds. I will sing with the flowers. I will pray to the stars. For both of us. As long as I can, I will remember how many things on this earth were your joy, and I will live as well as you would want me to live, as long as I can. Thank you, Karen.
Karen loved all the O Brother, Where Art Thou songs and all the old-timey music songs. And so Keep on the Sunny Side is just the good advice that she demonstrated throughout her life. So please join us. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Reverend Pam, and I'm one of the staff ministers here at the center, and also a good friend of Karen's. And it's my privilege, my honor right now to introduce Robert and Tanda Brueger. And Robert, or Bobby, as I originally called him, and he informed me very quickly, Karen was the only one that had the privilege of calling him Bobby. So I kind of think of him that way. But it's been a real honor to get to know Robert and Tanda. Karen loved them very dearly, very deeply. I didn't really know any of Karen's family at all until her passing, and got to meet these two lovely, lovely people. And have had some wonderful communications with them. And they have, from a distance, they live in Oregon, been in communication with us. And it's just been a real honor. So I would like to invite Bobby up. And he's going to say a few words about Karen.
I think today you can all call me Bobby. That's for Karen. And I don't have a speech or anything, just some notes. It's amazing to see everyone here. It's not surprising, but it is amazing. She obviously had such a large circle of friends and true family here in Reading and other places that she's been. So it's amazing to me. Karen was my closest cousin. I've got a lot of cousins. She was my closest cousin. I could talk to her about things. I wish that I had talked to her about more things, but she was my closest cousin. More a sister, actually, in my heart. So she had that effect on everyone she met. She opened her heart, and you couldn't help but embrace her. Some early memories. I remembered some things growing up, and one of the things that first came to my mind, my uncle had a cottage. The Finger Lakes, or actually Canisius Lake in upstate New York, which is where her family is from and where I'm originally from. And there was, when I was a young one, I guess I did something I wasn't supposed to do. I walked out the edge of the dock and somehow ended up falling into the water. Somebody pulled me out because I didn't know how to swim. I think it was my uncle. But from that point on, I was very fearful of water, and I wanted nothing to do with the water. I cried when I went near the water, but my cousin was there, my cousin Karen, and I remember, even when I was so little, that she spent so much time, patience, and she would, she just worked myself back towards the water. She would slowly bring me in, and I'd freak out, and then she'd take me out a little bit, and then she'd bring me back in, but my love of water returned. I love water to this day. I love scuba diving, so it's all thanks to Karen for getting me through that challenge. You know, she was, on my notes, she was my goofy cousin. She was my goofy cousin. We could always be goofy with her, and as I was growing up, I just loved spending time with her. We would go and visit. My mom and dad would go visit my Aunt Pat. And we would have such a great time. And when it was time to leave, I would get all upset because I didn't want to leave Karen because I was having such a great time. And she would say, "See you later, alligator." And I'd say, after a while, crocodile. And then I'd... So anyway, she was so fun to be around when I was growing up and to this day. But there was a long stretch. I went into the Army and spent 21 years in the Army, so I was away quite a bit. So we kind of grew apart. We corresponded a bit through those years. But she always remembered me when I was deployed. I would get, this is when she was in New Hampshire, I think, Vermont or New Hampshire. And I remember getting these care packages, and it would be full of like the maple popcorn, bags of maple popcorn, and it was so awesome. The guys in my unit loved it too, so. And she sent me some bona fide maple syrup. She probably took it out of a tree herself, I'm sure. So, but that was great because that made the MREs taste a lot better. So that was awesome. But she was always thinking of me. She was sending me stuff out there, and I loved her for it. I truly did. Later on, you know, after I got out of the Army, and I met my wonderful wife, Tanda. Actually, we had been apart. I hadn't seen Karen in years, and it was Tanda that kind of prompted me, because I was up in Seattle and pretty much the only family member on the West Coast. And, it, you know, Tanda pushed me and said, hey, we got to get together with Karen. She's just down in Reading. It's just, you know, a short drive down there. I said, okay, so we did that, and I am so thankful to have gotten that reconnection. It was awesome. She I hadn't seen her in a while, so when we pulled up to her place down here, I said, well, I'm not sure I'm gonna recognize her. But as soon as I got out of the car, this woman starts running over and jumps on me and starts kissing me and going, Bobby, 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 and I'm like, I think this is Karen. I think this is her. So yeah. So that was great, and I'm so thankful to my wife for pushing me to do that, because I'm a procrastinator and I probably would have waited too long, and I'm glad I didn't. So she also, on my 50th birthday party, she came on, surprised me on my 50th birthday party. And then we had been dating at the time that we came down here, but she was able to make our wedding. And that was a blessing to me to be there. So she was always the life of the party, for sure. Loved being around her. She was passionate about her love for all living things, as everyone here, I think, knows that. And she just enjoyed every moment of life, and she would bring that out in everyone that she met. So it was her life was a blessing to me, to my family. I have my sister Cindy asked me to read some words. So she just wrote short words here. Okay, so I just have to get myself together here. Anyone who knew my cousin Karen is truly blessed. She was one of a kind, true spirit of peace, love, and kindness. Her love and devotion to the natural rural world around us beamed from her, and it is something that we had in common, a wonderful connection. She was blessed with the ability to entertain and teach this love to others. I recall that one of her favorite authors was Rachel Carson. Silent Spring being the one most people would think of, she wrote many others. And to honor Karen, I am going to read and reread, in some cases, these writings. They are profound in the messages they give to all of us about the natural world that Karen truly loved. I encourage you to do the same for Karen. And the following is a quote from Rachel Carson. Those who dwell among the beauties and mysteries of the earth are never alone or weary of life. In looking back, when someone passes, we always seem to wish, if only. those thoughts of Karen are with me now. I wish we could have had more conversations, more visits, more sharing of thoughts. Well, as in all deaths of people we love, we will have the if-onlys. Let us have less if-onlys. Make a commitment today with Karen in mind to not let days, weeks, months go by without connecting to the ones we love. At the same time, disconnect from this modern technical world that keeps us from experiencing what Karen so loved, the natural, awesome world right outside of our door. Can you picture Karen smiling right now? I can. And that was from my sister Cindy back in Rochester. Before I step down, I just want to, on behalf of Karen and our family, her family members, I want to thank everyone that has been so helpful putting this together. Roy and Diana, Reverend Pam and Sue, and all the other volunteers. It is so much appreciated. Thanks.
We're here to share Karen's life through song. And this next song, Georgia on My Mind, Karen loved to sing all different styles of music, especially the bluesy songs, and play her many harmonicas, which we are sorely missing today. This is Georgia on My Mind. Song speaks to the wonder that Karen saw in all things, especially in the natural world as we know. And she had a propensity to find the preciousness. Oops.
Sorry, Roy.
She had a propensity to find the preciousness in everything, especially our pets, as we've heard. This is I Have a Dream.
In Karen's own words, 11:30 in the morning, October 12th, 1995. I don't know where to start. Everything's happened so fast, and now it's mid-October. One minute, you have so many plans and so much to do. And the next, you're in the hospital. And you're told not to do those things for a while. Last week, or was it 2 weeks ago, I went by the Clyde River in North County High School. Was out there by the bridge. Did I feel guilty? Sad? Depressed? Yes. Because I was supposed to be out there with them. I wanted to be there, but couldn't due to heart failure. Not a heart attack, mind you, but heart failure. There has been talk of a heart transplant. My heart is only working without medication at 10%. I went back into the hospital last week. They wanted to check my arteries. They did, and they were clear as can be. I knew they would be. They had to be. I ate right. I had low blood pressure. I'm not overweight. Exercise. And have medium cholesterol levels. Still, somehow, I got a virus in my heart, which my immune system tried to fight by fighting my heart. My enlarged and boom, big trouble. A week before I saw the kids on the Clyde Lake region was going out, I could have gone and sat there and done some of the chemistry stuff, but my doctor and my husband advised against it. They thought I would end up doing more than that, given my usual demeanor about such things. True, my job was to put on some waders and get in the river with the kids. Plus, it's what I like to do. Even if I didn't do that, I probably would have been up and down for something on or another. The problem with this illness or disease is that I look healthy, but I tire easily. The guilt is the worst part. I signed on to help out everyone and cannot. Although I do plan to do some stuff in the classroom.
Greetings. My name's Reverend Mary Mitchell. I'm one assistant minister here with Reverend Sue. And we all, you know, so loved Karen. And with a forestry background from Ohio State and also being an author, every time Karen and I met, we always had something to talk about. It was wonderful. And I was blessed to be able to go on a hike with her and some other folks she was taking out along the upper Sac near Dunsmuir, and she gave everybody this wonderful little notebook and a pen, and you could write, and she always wrote a poem in the front of it. So you had something to inspire yourself. Remember, as you were walking along, as she was identifying the 1,143rd thing that you saw that you never really saw before because you didn't know. And so the story was found in her things, and they asked me to read it, and I just feel so blessed to do that. And it's called In the Closet. In the Closet, a short story by Karen M. Coffey. The question behind my investigation was a pretty simple one. Who was this guy? Was he the person he portrayed himself to be? Was there some deep, dark secrets lurking in the background of his life? What kind of person was he? I needed to know. And I figured the best way out was to look inside the closet. When I first opened the closet, it seemed to be a typical closet for the human male species. There were a few shirts ranging in colors from white to pale blue, white with pinstripes, pale blue with checks, some off their hangers or half on depending on how you looked at it. Next to the shirts were a couple of sports jackets, one gray with white herringbone and one plain navy blue. Some ties were hanging helter-skelter on hangers, about 10 in all, in various shades of blue and green. A conservative array of clothing, to say the least. There were no brightly colored Hawaiian shirts with big splashy flowers, no designer silk shirts or suits, and there was not a logo t-shirt to be found. On top of some boxes were rolled up casual pants and a couple of shoes, pair of shoes on top of them, one brown and one black. Beside the boxes on the floor were five more pair of shoes, consisting of running shoes, work boots, dress shoes, hiking boots, and wading shoes. Although there was an old beat-up tennis racket in the back of the closet with a half a can of tennis balls next to it, there were not any tennis shoes. Then, as I looked up again and peered through the clothes hanging on the right side of the closet, I spotted a drab olive vest. It was heavy cloth material, short with many, many pockets. It was a fishing vest. I pulled it out to get a closer look. What a wonderful thing. Colorful, bright, shiny pins, intricately embroidered patches adorned the pockets and the back of the vest. The pockets seemed to be bulging with things that one could only wonder about, so instead of wondering, I decided to take a look inside, and what wonderful treasures there were. The pocket I looked inside first was the smallest of them all, and it held a precious little stone. It was almost perfectly round, about a half inch in diameter. Flatter on one side than the other, greenish-gray in color, with rust-colored streaks going through it on a diagonal. Only Karen could have noticed that. Scattered throughout the small stone were golden specks that sparkled in the light. What an unusual mix of colors and patterns. I wonder where he found it. The next pocket, much larger, produced a see-through gold box that opened on the top and on the bottom. Inside there were many different compartments, and each one held a special treat. One compartment had long feathers of bright yellow and deep red with a piece of silver foil in the middle. Another held emerald green and deep blue feathers with black stripes at the end. And yet another had bright orange fluffy feathers that seemed to wave back and forth with the slightest breath of air. All these exotic feathers were tied to different hooks. I couldn't help but wonder what kind of a special man it took to appreciate, as I did, these colorful creations as I slipped the box back into its pocket. On the lower left-hand side of the vest was a horizontal, medium-sized pocket. As I unzipped it, I could see a metal spiral shape. Ah, a notebook. It had a yellow cover with waterproof paper inside. As I took a closer look, it appeared to be a fishing journal. Each entry had the date, the time, the name of the river or stream, where it was located, the water temperature, and air temperature, the type and the name of the fly that was used, and a record of any fish that was caught and released. But this journal had far more to it than just simple data. Each entry also had a lengthy explanation about the color of the water, the color of the sky, the types of wildflowers along the bank, the kind of birds that flew overhead or were in the water, and the types of trees that were along the different stretches of the river as he waded through the riffles. Along with each entry, there were small sketches that depicted the mood of the day and the special features that he thought were so important. As I held the journal in my hand, tears began to surface. In part, it was due to the sheer beauty of the moment. That moment was captured in the descriptions and pictures. But also, it was due to the knowledge that this was just not an ordinary man. He had kept an incredibly thoughtful journal. This was a special man with deep feelings about nature and about life. This was a man I wish I could have known at this level, the level he seemed to find when alone on the river. I will miss my father dearly. And if I only had one wish, it would be that I could have stood with him in these special places that he obviously loved so much. In his closet, I didn't find any sordid secrets or surly past experiences of a man I did not know, but instead I found exactly what I was looking for, a very special connection to my dad.
So many treats and surprises, all these wonderful writings. So it's my privilege today to share just a few words about Karen's life, and my focus will really be about who Karen was to all of us here at the center. Because what is really true about life is that we remember a person for the love that they shared with us, rather than in any way about their fame or their fortune or even their accomplishments. The things that we remember really about people are the love that they engendered in us, that they brought up in us, and how we felt that, and how we felt in general when we were with that person. And that's what we're really celebrating today, and celebrating Karen. And that said, Karen was indeed a brilliant woman. She had an incredible career. She had many accomplishments that were just really fabulous. If you look at some of the things on the memory tables out there, you're going to find awards that she received and just major things. So I invite you to do that. And also, all of that is outlined in the obituary that was written so lovingly by Robert about Karen. She was indeed remarkable in that way, but she was also a humble person. And when she came to us, when she came here, she was pretty much retired from her career and all those accomplishments. So unless you really ask her, and I did talk with her briefly sometimes about some of that, you wouldn't necessarily know that. So I think there's also some copies of her obituary back there if some of you want more details about those aspects of her life. But I just wanted to share based on my own personal knowledge of Karen. And also I'll share some words of another very, very close and deep friend of hers and of mine as well. Just to help paint a picture of this really, really incredible woman that each one of us in here had our own very unique and special relationship with. And that statement right there is really the beginning, and it's already been referred to, of the most important sharing about Karen was that more than one person has said, as Sue mentioned earlier, that just Karen had a way of making you feel when you were with her like you were the most special person in her life. And indeed, that was absolutely true in the moment. In the time and the moment that she was sharing with you, with each one of you, you were that most special person in her life. Karen had a way of just also appreciating, didn't she? She could appreciate you and appreciate your pet, right? And in my case, appreciate your granddaughter as well. Like no one else could do, she could appreciate all those things. So the basis of my sharing is I brought a birthday card that I got from Karen last year that's been at home on my piano, and I'm sure several of you have cards similar to this, but it in every way just depicts who Karen was, I think, for all of us. And It's a card from an organization called Heron Dance that's based in Vermont. And their motto is, every word is Karen, reconnecting with our wild souls. And so it has a beautiful pale watercolor on the front, just in blues and whites of the sunlight coming through the trees. And in that dappled light is a beautiful hiker in the middle there, right here with his little backpack and a hiking staff. And on the front it says, now shall I walk or shall I ride? Ride, pleasure said. Walk, joy replied. And on the inside, of course, she drew her love, her heart, radiating all that love out of it. And then she says, oh, yes, walk, hike, my friend, into the woods down by the river. Joy and love awaits you. And then she comments on the little gifts that she had given me, and this is so Karen. Enjoy the wonderful smell of the moisturizer candle, which I have on my body today. She gave me this great candle that you melt it and then you put the oil on your skin. It's just really awesome. Pamper yourself, she says. Then have some sweet, salty, dark chocolate. Mmm. Life is good. And then she says, and it just strikes me with all of her writings, you know how life reflects us. We are mirrors. And everything she wrote to or about other people was just really about so reflective of herself, of who she was. She says, happy birthday, dearest Pam. You are so very dear to me, as you are to so many. And isn't that just about Karen? And then she ends with a beautiful quote from the Bhagavad Gita. The body is mortal, but the person dwelling in the body is immortal and immeasurable. And then she signs off. Love, Karen Coffey. Lots of love and kisses. So that to me just depicts her, and I know you probably, many of you, could be up here sharing exactly the same way. I connected with Karen here at the center mainly, and as my kitty sitter. And on a few occasions, and I mentioned my granddaughter earlier, she got to house sit my kitty, but at that time my teenage young adult granddaughter was living with me, and I was gone. And so I'd kind of put the bug in Karen's ear, so she'd kind of keep a close eye that at least we knew my granddaughter was still alive on the planet and coming back and forth to the house occasionally. And Karen just had a way of spreading her loving arms and her compassion and her care around all of that. My home, my animals, my family. Indeed, I knew that when I was gone and Karen was about, that things were well, and I could trust that. She just loved the whole situation all the time. She even brought my granddaughter gifts, little gifts. I'm wearing today earrings, little musical notes. These little earrings that Karen gave to me. We were at a women's retreat one time, and there happened to be a yard sale down the street from the ashram that we were in up in Nevada City. And a lot of the women just couldn't resist going down to that yard sale. And of course, Karen was right there. And she came back about an hour later, and she brought in this beautiful Punjabi, white Punjabi top that she bought me, and she just said, I just saw this, and it was you. I had to get it for you. And that's who she was. Karen's thoughtfulness was just absolutely immense. Absolutely immense. Thoughtful in every way. My very fun connection, of course, with Karen, like so many of us, was through her music.
I was absolutely a groupie for Acoustic Summer. All of Sandy and Gil and Karen and Michael's performances I would attend. And then, of course, I knew her as well. She would come to these informal musical gatherings at my friend Podge's house. He has these a lot of incredibly good, talented musicians that gather, and some of them are sitting in this room today, and just share music and take your turn. And she would bring her drum, her guitar, her harmonicas, her voice, her songs, and just offer out in the opportunity she had her music and herself through that. And the people today have represented her so beautifully in that. I know she's totally enjoying it. So I want to now share a couple of thoughts. I ask my good friend, Muffy Berryhill, if she would offer a couple of thoughts. And she just was delighted to do that. She and Karen got to know each other in the last maybe 3 or 4 years and ended up doing a lot of things together, spending some wonderful time. And so she has this to share. Karen wrote this note to me in May 2016, right after I faced a significant loss in my family. Reading it again now, as I face the loss of Karen, I am reminded once more to savor the moments we share with our dear ones. These moments are fleeting, not to be captured except in our memories. So Karen wrote to Muffy, people travel with us through time in our lives. We do not always choose them, though they become our traveling companions. The time they are with us varies. Memories are formed. Friendships are made. These are special times. Yet time itself eludes us. What seems forever, at some point, is gone. Where did it go? Why can we not capture it and the people who stood beside us? In a second note, in a note from Karen on my birthday, she included this quote from Robert Louis Stevenson. He speaks of the type of friend we all found Karen to be. And Stevenson's words are, we are all travelers in the wilderness of this world, and the best that we find in our travels is an honest friend. Muffy notes that she knew Karen for 3 or 4 years, but in that time, I learned so much about the natural wonders of our earth, about animals, about trees, about kindness, and friendship, about acting in accordance with your beliefs, and about showing up when support and effort are needed. Since Karen died, I have talked to others who agreed that she was someone who could form fast and deep friendships in a very short period of time. She was a person who was genuine, who loved to laugh and was able to share the joys of life, as well as life's struggles and sadness, an honest friend indeed. And just one more very short. One of the people, an old friend of hers who lives in Westport, Maine, was contacted about the news, and I'm not going to read the whole thing, but part of what this woman, Mary Ellen, shared, who was a good friend of Karen's, I guess they first met in the 1970s, and she says, we've shared a few personal challenges over the years. Karen would truly listen, help puzzle things out, and be there however and whenever needed. She was a wacky, generous, loyal, inexhaustible soul, connecting people and love. Won't be letting go of this fierce and fun friend anytime soon. And now I believe we have some music. Sandy and Gil and Michael.
We're her bandmates, Acoustic Summer, and our band started back in 2011, and it was Gil and I, and we recruited Michael, the bass player, and then we recruited Karen, because she could sing, and she had our harmonicas, and she was so much fun, and so we had her come and play with us a few times just as a guest musician. We wrote it on our posters, Karen Coffey, guest musician playing harmonica. And then when we decided to induct her into our band formally, we presented her with a framed poster of the gig where we were at. We were at Brick Smokehouse. We're out on the patio, and it was 104 degrees, and we were dying.
And it was in the sun.
It was in the sun. But we had fun, and our last gig that we did with her was back in September on the 30th at the Grape Escape, one of our favorite places to go because it's just so much fun. Karen was on fire. She had her congas, she was playing her harmonicas, and we're looking at her going, wow, I've never seen her be like that. She was just out there all over the place, and we knew she wasn't feeling good. She was feeling tired, and her leg was swollen, all, but she was out there having fun and just playing it to the fullest, and just goofy and silly and a tremendous amount of fun. And so today we're going to do two of her original songs, which I just learned how to sing them last night. Because I always sang backup vocals for her, so I never sang the lead on it, so we're going to try and do this, and I am so missing her harmonicas with us. It's just, she was wild and fun, that your one wild and precious life, Mary Oliver poem, it's gorgeous, but it's her. And this first song she wrote, it's called The Uncomplicated Blues, because she loved the blues.
I want to make sure I'm coming out. Thank you.
count the years upon my hand, but until that time is up and going, I'll hug a tree and I'll walk upon the land, because I'm not a complicated woman, oh no, but I lead a complicated life. No, I'm not a complicated woman. Why do I lead this? Why do I lead this? Complicated life.
Karen Coffey, original song. This other one's kind of goofy. It's called Sweet Potato Fries. We're in rehearsal down in the basement studio one night, and she comes in and she's like, "You guys, I wrote this new song. It's about sweet potato fries." And we're like, "Karen, we got a gig coming up. We got all this stuff going through." And she says, "No, you got to hear it. You got to hear it. It's really good." But reminds me of the time when she would call, and she would, if you didn't get back to her, she'd call and leave messages. So I had a message on my phone from one time. She says, "Hey, Sandy, don't know if you're far or you're near. Let's go down to Shameless O'Berry's, have some chips and a beer." So this is part of her other goofiness and stuff that she loved. Sweet Potato Fries by Karen Coffey. Potato fries, wedges and slices could be my demise. I have a little fat and vitamins too. Sweet potato fries are good for you. They are crispy on the outside and soft within. Whenever I eat them, I get a big grin. You can dip them in mustard and vinegar too. But don't use ketchup, cause that's taboo. I love my sweet potato fries. Everybody sing.
Sweet potato fries.
I love my
sweet potato fries.
Driving in my car into the drive-thru. Give me sweet potatoes, fries, small with you. But don't forget the mustard and the honey mustard sauce. But no salt, please, cause it tastes good. Sweet potato fries. I had a boyfriend, cute as could be. Thought he was just the right guy for me, but he ate all my sweet potato fries one day.
Oops.
And now that boyfriend is gone away. He ate my
sweet potato fries.
Don't eat my sweet potato fries. I love my
sweet potato fries. 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 Sweet potato fries.
One more time.
Sweet potato fries. Sweet potato fries.
I love my
sweet potato fries. Sweet potato fries. Sweet potato fries. Sweet potato fries. Sweet potato fries.
Sweet potato fries.
Been a year since he touched the guitar.
Spirit of the wind, Spirit of the wind, Spirit of the wind, Spirit of the wind, carry me, Spirit. Spirit of the wind, carry me home to myself. Spirit of the ocean, deepest emotion, Spirit of the sea, set me free. Spirit
invite Pam to join me on the stage. This, thank you for your attention here today. It's a beautiful service, the starting with Holly Day, singing one of Karen's favorite about the trees. It's time for us to release, though. I want to honor the friends that are here, the people from the Shasta Land Trust that made your way here today to share this time with us, and the members of the center, the family, the friends that know Karen through our family here. But so many of you have graced our presence, just showing such deep intention and heart, and the music, incredible. But it is time. It is time to let go of Karen. She drew us here together in this room, and we've waited for this day to celebrate her life. So we come together having witnessed the tapestry of her life. And I found in her writing a couple of things that'll lighten your heart a little bit about what she thought would happen for herself when she passed. And I'll have Pam read a couple of those.
Okay, let's see. So Karen had an experience in November of seeing twin mountain lion cubs, about 25 feet away from her, 25 yards away from her when she was walking one day, and she wrote all about it. But then what I just want to share with you is, she said, "For me, this experience makes my top 10 list of special and remarkable things to be thankful for. Not just seeing the young in the wild by myself, but also that I can write about it." She says, "When I am dying, put me in a boat and send me off into the water in such a place as this. A bit of Beaugest in me. Or lay me down by a river," and she puts Battle Creek, question mark, "with tall conifers overhead. There is not a more beautiful sound to me than that of the wood or the hermit thrush. It is the twinkly lilt of the forest." And finally, the Karen that we all know and love. "When I die, I want to go skidding up to the pearly gates, partly party hat askew, champagne in one hand, chocolate-dipped strawberries in the other, shouting, 'Woohoo, what a ride!'"
So sweet, so Karen. So let us take a moment in your own heart and quietly realize that we've been held in the presence of love. And each one of you have had memories flow through you, and recognizing that that is God speaks through you. And I invite you to hold on to your memories. Those are yours, and cherish those. And but we're going to release the person to move on. We're here to say goodbye and to support each other now as we say that goodbye. And remembering that we're each here with our own personal knowing of God, our life. And we each try to understand something about death, but it's always a mystery to each one of us left behind. But Karen has made a very graceful exit, and it is her soul that is choosing now, and the spirit to whom we wish Godspeed. Ernest Holmes is the founder of our philosophy, and he reminds us that it is human to grieve. It is human to grieve over the loss of a loved one. We love them, yes, and we will miss them. But let us find comfort in knowing that they're in God's keeping, and they're safe, and that we believe in the immortality and the continuity of an individualized soul. Their life is still flowing in the current of eternity. We choose to feel that we have not lost them. They've just gone before us. Ernest Holmes reflects that this great event of the soul passing is so beautiful and such a glorious experience. It's like the eagle who is freed from its cage, soars to its native heights, so the soul is freed from the home of heavy flesh and heart disease. She will rise. She's returned to her true nature. She's naked and unafraid. So we let go of the pain and the grief. We allow it to just fade into a knowing of perfect love. Nothing can be added to this moment that we celebrated today. This connection with Karen holds us even more closely together. I want to share this testimony, a letter to Karen. "Dear Karen, I have been listening. I've been listening to the story of your life. I've discovered some things. Thank you for awakening us to the beauty of nature when we were asleep in our knowing. Thank you for being right by each one of us through these recent days of effort and sadness, and letting us feel your smile and your presence, your kiss on our cheek. Thank you, Karen, for your courage and steadfastness and caring for our rivers and our land, for our animals, both wild and domestic. Thank you for sharing your inspiring story of the two hearts that lived in you. Thank you for being the faithful cousin that knew true connection. Thank you for loving our pets and keeping their well-being first and foremost in your heart. Thank you for bringing so much joy to us through the passion of your song, through the harmonica, through the drum, through every inspirational song. Through your power to gather friends and know the common note to sing. Thank you for making every one of us feel like we truly were your best friend. So we let go of our pain to free you, Karen. You have blessed our lives, and we will forever, ever miss you. We love you. Goodbye, my friend. Love, Sue. So there is a tradition, and I invite you all to stand. And I would like to invite to the stage, to the front part of here, to stand in this moment. Those that have been tending to her apartment, will you please come forward and stand and be here? Roy and Diana, Mary, many of you, Jillian, please, please come forward. This is to honor Karen. Stand right up here, please. And for Bobby, Tanda, please stand. And Terry, for being here today. I'll let you sit there, please. Those of you, these are the hearts that have been tending to something that's been very difficult, and Karen would love for you to be honored in this moment. So we stand in true knowledge of the work and the grace that you have done in putting this all together and creating this beautiful day. Those that helped set up the sanctuary with memory altars to her, all of you are so important. If you're too shy to step forward, it's just Karen longing for you to be recognized. I invite all of those that are standing to face the stage, to face her ashes. So those in the front, just turn towards the front of the stage here and recognize Karen. The Lord is your shepherd, and you shall never want for the life and the love. God will for eternity make you to lie down in the green pastures of an abundant life, to lie down by the rivers you were so instrumental in keeping fresh and clean, to lie down on the precious Mother Earth you knew to be sacred land. This love will always lead you beside the still waters of peace. It will restore your awareness of your true self. God will lead you on the path of your true nature. Yea, though you have walked through the valley of the shadow of death, you now know it to be a shadow only, and you fear no evil. For you remember that you and the Father and the Mother are one. This infinite love and law shall comfort you. God has already prepared your new expression for you. Even in the presence of any fear, your knowing is complete. We know that your cup is truly running over. We celebrate with you your love and the soul connection to the two-legged and the four-legged, the winged and the finned and the furred, and all the kingdoms of life and your unconditional love of all relations. Your life expression was filled with love for your friends and family and those in the community you tirelessly served. All this good goes with you to make your spirit glow. And the light of our love for you will make you shine forever in the next place you are. Surely goodness is your true eternal nature, and you are in the image and likeness of God forevermore. Therefore, in the name of the Christ consciousness within us all, with this word, I now sever the bonds of earthly beliefs and possessive thoughts and release you, Karen, into the one infinite life from which you have come. We are so blessed by knowing and loving you, and in that knowing, you will never be forgotten. The spirit of life and love holds you now, and so it is. I'll invite Pam forward to hold up the candle. And as she holds this candle up, recognize that this next breath you breathe with us is carrying Karen home. She is free, and our love remains strong. Blow it out. And as we stand here, we're going to hold this parting glass as the rest of you sit down, and the final song is sung in honor. We thank you. The friends have gathered food, and good food, Karen food, and we truly invite you to stay and share your stories that you were holding so close to your heart this evening, and join us in celebrating with food. And remember, take hats and scarves and bags. She had bags. She had bags. So they're your gifts. They're your gifts. And take them and have fun and dress up and be goofy. And anything else you want me to share, Diana? Let's have fun. Thank you. God bless you all. Thank you.